welcome to the CPC meeting Wednesday, October 19th, 2016. As always, we start with general public comment. Is there anyone who would like to say anything? No? Okay. Is there a motion to approve the minutes of October the 5th? Second?
Okay.
Any discussion? Linda?
Just one tiny little thing, Sarah, on the, there was a discussion of the amount of pristine open space. I don't remember who asked that. And I think his initial answer was that there was 20% was preserved, but less than that, and I don't remember the exact amount, was pristine. So just in case we refer to it in the future.
Thank you. We can always trust you to actually read the minutes and comment on them. Any other discussion on the minutes? All in favor of approval? Opposed? Thank you very much. Chair's report. When folks leave the committee, we try to offer them something of to remember us by. So Devin Bruce left with a new representative coming, Ann Brooks from the planning board. So we'd like to propose that Sarah scrounge out something to send to Devin. In the past, we've given, aren't they the what are they, Sarah? The, I want to say it's 350th memento thing. So if that's all right with folks, we'll send that along with a letter thanking her for her 2 years of service.
Was it more than that?
Yeah, three, four?
Nice,
whatever it was. And maybe we can all sign something at some point so that, that we do that. Great. Thank you. And that's it for the chair's report. So we are around our second meeting with applicants. 2 weeks ago, we met with Wayne Fiden, who had five proposals coming in from the city. This evening, we'll be doing Beaverbrook, Broadbrook improvements with BBC reporting on that. The Trustees of Smith Charities historic building study, and the third one is Hampshire County Courthouse restoration. So folks who are speaking to those proposals, we have all read your proposals. We have submitted questions that you then answered. We have read the answers to those questions. We have not discussed anything among ourselves yet. 2 weeks from tonight, we'll be having the public comment. So folks who are interested in supporting your proposals, you can ask them to come and make their voices heard. We reserve that meeting simply to hear public comments on the eight proposals. Is that what it is? That we have? So, without further ado, we'll begin with Beaverbrook Broadbrook improvements. Bob, is that you?
Yes. Mm-hmm. I'm Bob Zimmerman. I live on North Farms Road, and I'm also president of Broadbrook Coalition. I will do some of the presentations together with Jason Johnson from the Civic Association, because this is a joint project between the two organizations. The Beaverbrook Broadbrook area was purchased by the city in 2010. It was a 102-acre parcel, a large part of which was an old farm, which had really come into disrepair. And hadn't been, the land hadn't been worked for a number of years. The area, as you can see, is bounded on the west side by Route 9 or Haydenville Road, and the Broad Brook, which is that blackish, greenish line, sort of just right center of the diagram, provides another kind of division in the area. And the proposal that we're going to discuss tonight really has to do with a strip of land, about 6 acres, between Haydenville Road and Beaver Brook. Now, when the city purchased the land, there were all kinds of surveys and recommendations made, but no group or no existing group or no new group of people agreed to take on the stewardship of the area. So it kind of languished for a number of years. In the spring of 2013, we got a group of people together, 15 or 20 people from the community, to do a pretty big cleanup in this area that you see on the map. And we got all kinds of tires and hose. There seemed to be a couple of miles of old hoses on the property for some reason, and old pieces of metal and so forth. And with Sarah Lally's help, we were able to pile that stuff up and get it removed from the site. And about the same time, the city applied for, I believe it was a state grant, to do some work on the invasive plants, which just covered the area pretty much. And some work was done at that point, but not too much follow-up. So the area remained in kind of questionable state at that point, and a group of people from Broadway Coalition and Lead Civic Association got together in 2015 and dedicated ourselves to doing something to improve the habitat there and make it a decent area for people to visit. And over a period of a little over a year, we met probably a dozen times to make plans to scout the area, explore it, see what we could do with it, make some plans, and also seek some money to finance the plans that we had to improve the area. Now, as I mentioned, we decided to focus on this 6-acre portion out of the 102 acres, really because of its accessibility. It's right along Route 9, easily visited by people. The backland on the other side, to the east of the Beaver Brook, is pretty inaccessible right now. And we decided that we would have enough to do improving the habitat and the visibility of the area to the west of Broad Brook, that we would focus on that area. So the elements of the plan as they emerged was to have a parking area, which is indicated in blue lettering down in the lower left corner of the map there. It's actually on the property of the corrosion facility, which is adjacent to the conservation area. And we've gotten permission of DPW to use that as a parking area for 4 or 5 cars. We'll also have a kiosk, excuse me, to tell people a little about the area as they enter the property. And in the central area where you see some yellow lettering, central area, we're going to have some picnic tables and some interpretive signs to describe the both the history of the area when it was a farm, and maybe even before, as well as the natural history of the area. We're also we have already laid out some trails, and we're going to clear the trails. The trails are colored in various colors, green, blue, and red, going to the north and the south from that central area. And there are a number of interesting things to be seen on those trails, some of which are old pieces of farm equipment that have laid there unused for I don't know how many years, but are still in recognizable shape and kind of interesting for their history. We're also going to put a wildlife blind in the position where there's yellow lettering at the top of the slide, at the top of the map, and that will overlook a beaver pond and a portion of the stream itself. Good site for seeing wildlife, all kinds of birds, and of course you can see beavers there if you're lucky. They are industriously improving the area from their point of view all the time, and other mammals as well, with good luck. Then, let's see, what else are we going to have, or do actually, we're going to brush hog some of the area that is free of trees. It's a part of the area, the central area is quite heavily wooded, but to the north and the south there's some relatively open area. It is a recognized area for a species of special concern in Massachusetts, wood turtle, and by mowing those areas, not letting the grass and other brush get too dense, it will help improve the habitat for wood turtles, and for other animals as well. And finally, the question of invasive species. The 6-acre strip that we've been talking about is still full of a lot of different kinds of invasive plants. Some attempt has been made, as I mentioned, to keep the bittersweet under control and also Japanese knotweed, but there are a lot of other invasive plants growing in that area, which we are going to approach either by hand clearing or digging or herbicide treatment. The only other thing that's not on this map is represents the fact that this area is at a gateway to the city, one of the major gateways to the city, and we would love it if eventually the city would put up a welcome to Northampton sign, a gateway sign, sort of in the upper left corner of that of the map. That is not part of the present application, but it's something we hope the city may do in the future. So I'm going to just show you another slide. The next slide shows you some of the areas, some of the views of the areas. I don't think this was part of the application, but the on the upper left is a view in the fall of the central area. The upper right is the view from where the wildlife blind will be placed. The middle slide to the left is a beaver pond, one of the beaver ponds in the area, and then a couple of views of the trail and trails, where the trails will be. And in the lower right is the parking area last winter on the edge of the corrosion facility. Luckily, the DPW has plowed that area, not at our request. We hope they will continue plowing it so it can be used in the winter as well. So I'm going to let Jason take over and tell you more of the specifics of the individual parts of the application.
Thank you. My name is Jason Johnson. I live in Leeds on Main Street. I'm a member of the Leeds Civic Association, the board. I'm also the chair of the Leeds Mill River Greenway Committee. So when Bob came to us asking for some support about this project, we were very interested. We work on many other conservation properties in Leeds and have the task of walking boundaries and picking up garbage and sort of stewarding some of these areas. And I really appreciate your comments and the questions that you sent in, because those were prescient to some of the issues that we've been discussing over the last year as far as ongoing stewardship and who's going to be taking care of things. We really think that this area is special and neglected in a way that it was getting overgrown to the point where it wasn't very hospitable to be able to get in there. So when we had our first work day and had about 8 people working for about 4 hours, you know, we really managed to clear up enough of an area where you could clearly walk out to the blind, and it became, you know, pretty obvious about where a good place to start would be. And we'd love to have a bridge going over to the rest of the 80 acres that goes up the hill. That's phenomenal habitat, multi-story mature forests, beautiful grasslands. But this is a fabulous starting point, and I think it's manageable from the point of being able to have a crew of 5 or 10 volunteers be able to mow and maintain the trails every given year. I think Bob has really explained the majority of the core portions of the proposal. I have walked the entire property, the entire boundary of the property, and would be prepared to entertain any questions, any further questions that you have.
Jason, there are a couple more slides that just show a little more detail.
Yeah, so if we, this is the map board or the interpretive board. We really think that this is a great, you know, opportunity again to have something there. There really is nothing there except a small conservation area sign right now. So this would at least be able to area to provide the trail system, provide some handouts for people that are coming and using the area, having rules and regulations for using a conservation area and sort of orienting the users to the site. The next slide is just a picnic, an example of the picnic benches that we put there. The next slide is a mock-up of the wildlife line. And we had a number of different ideas about this. We had several timber framers who have been experienced at using salvaged wood. There is a good deal of locust on the property, which is good for, you know, utilizing for projects like this. Once we have funding secured, I think we can discuss more in detail with the contractor what the possibilities are. But this is a great basic design for a similar wildlife barn that's used in other conservation areas. Next slide. These are the sawmill that the trees have actually grown around and just taken over. And my children were particularly fascinated by this and wondering, you know, which came first. Did the sawmill come first when the tree grew over it, or was the sawmill put through the tree? You know, it really is something that you don't have to do much to develop because this sense of time and different use of the property. And the bottom is this interesting horse-drawn hay tether, which is also in really, you know, good condition considering it's still standing up. And again, it's not going to need to be moved or anything, but the trail is brought right to the edge of that. And, you know, its former use along with some historic photos will be able to enhance the appreciation of the public of these historic farm tools.
So what's the length of the trail that you've drawn? Roughly?
I think it's about a mile and a half, 2 miles.
The total extent of the trail?
Yes.
You know, I don't know. Maybe a little bit less than that. We have a scale there.
Feet, yeah, maybe a quarter mile. I think it's 3/4 of a mile, maybe.
Yeah.
All the way around. There's a nice loop. You know, they have, it's a double loop. So one comes out the wildlife blind, and it comes back around the gardens.
Do you think 4 parking places, 5 parking places?
Well, I think it's a good start.
There's really more space there. I wondered if they had limited you, because if there's more space.
There is more space around the roundabout,
yeah,
but they also
yeah.
said that they didn't want anybody parking in the roundabout area because okay. the delivery trucks come and deliver mm-hmm. chemicals to the corrosion treatment mm-hmm. plant. So the area that we chose is nice and flat. Mm-hmm. It doesn't appear to be too muddy in the winter. So we're just going to have to sort of see how it goes. I think as popularity increases, if we need to make more parking, there is more space along the road to improve, and there's also no driveway that goes actually in.
Right. Jason, what's the current membership of the Civic Association? The number of members?
Of the Lead Civic Association? I think we're about at 140. Yeah, it is good. We're a tight community and have other projects going forward with preservation, historic walks, and the same person who's doing the signage project is also slated to do this signage project for this project.
Project Coalition is about, we have about 225 members now.
Who would be doing the invasive plant control?
Well, there are a number of possibilities. There are, there's at least one person in our number, Lori Sanders, who's here tonight, who has an herbicide applicator license. So it could be, and I think another member, I think
that person does
Matt has one too. So there are two members of the seven member group that's been working on this. Who do have applicator licenses. There's a possibility of hiring people from the outside to do invasives work. Some of it can hopefully be done by digging or cutting, probably not an awful lot of it, because there are a lot of woody invasives in this 6-acre strip. that really need to be treated with herbicide to ensure getting rid of them.
Other questions? Everybody's good?
Chris Ellman. Hey, Lori. I guess this is probably directed to you. When you do the herbicide stuff, is a license enough, or do you have to get a permit for doing that?
We applied. I have a permit now, right now, through the city with a different contract, and we went to the Conservation Commission and applied with a using a request for determination of applicability. And so the permit that we have for this year's application in 14 other conservation areas is for cut stump treatment. So it's not foliar spray application. It's just cut it and apply it. So you don't. I like that because you don't have non-target species get zapped, and there's no, you know, drift or anything like that.
One thing I forgot to mention was is that this project has been submitted in the form of a notice of intent to the Conservation Commission and has been approved by the Conservation Commission. They have issued an order of conditions, which are pretty consistent with what we propose doing. And it's also been signed off on by DEP and by the Natural Heritage Program of DCR because it is a estimated habitat for wood turtle.
So just with that, does that mean you consider it like you're good to go?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any questions for Bob or Jason? Thank you very much. And again, we encourage you to bring folks if you would like to speak to the proposal 2 weeks from now.
Thanks, Hugo. And thanks very much for considering our application.
Thank you. Okay, so the next proposal is the historic building study, the Smith Charities, 51 Main Street. Someone to speak for that?
Lydia Zish, I'm the current president of Smith Charities. Going to be pretty brief. It's my first time doing a proposal. And I actually, if you've all read the application, I put into it just about everything I could think of. I became the president a couple of years ago, and basically, Smith Charities. How many of you are familiar at all with Smith Charities? Okay. Smith Charities makes their money by lending out money. I don't know if anybody's ever gotten a mortgage from Smith Charities, but that's the way we make our money. And 20 years ago, when we put $110,000 into the building, interest rates were 13-14%, making lots of money. We all know where the interest rates have been for the last 15 years. So cuts, and we just have no money at this point. And I got in there and I'm like, well, what can we do? And it's like we're very limited on what we can do. So I said to the treasurer, I says, well, how about a grant? And she said, yeah, we could try for a grant. So the first thing I did was I went to a meeting for the Massachusetts Historical Society, and their recommendation was to start with a study, because a study is a professional eye looking at the building and what the building needs. And so that's kind of where I started. And the only matching grants that the state will recognize is CPC grants. So I was like, okay, so I figured I'd start with the CPC. If I can get the ball rolling and get some CPC funding, then in the spring I'll apply to the state for some matching funds. So then, because I haven't got enough to do, I decided, well, okay, Smith Charities services 9 communities. I think 6 of them have CPCs. So it's like, okay, the building's in Northampton, look for the bulk of the money from Northampton because it's a building in your community. But I'm like, well, wait a minute. the CPCs from the other communities, so I was like, okay, well, maybe I can apply to the others. So I'm going to try and apply to the others. It's going to be an uphill battle because, first of all, people don't like studies. They're not well received, but from talking to the people at the state, it's like that's really your where you lay your groundwork for any future work that you need to do. So basically, that's how I got here. So I'm kind of looking to you all to support this project, and if you all support it, then we're already working on our applications for Hatfield, who I'm going to try to get a chunk of change from, because that's where the history is. That's where Oliver Smith came from, was from Hatfield. So there's a lot of historical significance tied to Hatfield. Anybody have any, did any of you get a chance to go look at the building? It's open Monday through Friday, 9 to 3. Anyone's welcome to go in. The treasurer and the other woman that worked will be glad to give you a tour, show you around, let you see what the building looks like and, you know, what's going on with it, which is kind of why I want the study, is to find out where should I be sending the money? Where should we? We've got about $18,000, and that's it. And $18,000 on a building like that is absolutely nothing. Everybody keeps saying the interest rates are going up, but I've been hearing that for 5 years, and nothing's happening. So, we're kind of like, what can I do? Where can I get some money to help at least set the groundwork for any future work that we want to do. I don't know if you remember or saw, but I thought one of the more interesting things was the amount of money that Smith Charities has given back to these communities. I only had them go back to 2006, and Northampton received $79,325,000. Your citizens have in benefits from Smith Charities over the course since 2006. But that's just since 2006. We all, Hatfield, Northampton, East Hampton, the communities that Smith Charities serves has been receiving these funds for 150 years. So, you know, it's a lot of money. So we're just looking for some help. It's the first time we've had to reach out for help. They've never had to do it before. They did some work on the building about 20 years ago. It's in the packet. They got an award from Northampton for the work they did on the building, so we do, you know, take it seriously. We'd like to look at the upstairs to see if somehow we can do something with the upstairs, which is basically just some storage right now. There's a ton of room up there, but it's not accessible. The only access is the front door. This is my dream, is to redo the lobby at some point. I don't know, to see the pictures, they did a supposedly update in the 70s. And when I was looking at the building and looking around trying to see, okay, the mechanics and what's going on, there was some of that woodwork from the 1800s laying there in the corner of the basement. And my heart broke because it was absolutely gorgeous woodwork. And if we could somehow preserve that, that would be wonderful. But the reason we're looking for the money is we can't take it away from the kids, from the people that are benefiting from all of this. If we're putting money into the building, it's being taken away from them. So that's
when. You have no heat on the second floor?
No. No. One of the reasons Oliver left the church was because they installed heat. That was a waste of money.
Oh, one of those.
So there you go. So that's probably why, I don't know, the building was built after Oliver, but it was just kind of funny that's the reason, that's the story.
And have you plans or interest in using the second floor or renting it so you
well,
can get money? Is that what you're trying to do?
That's the feasibility. The feasibility of being able to do that. In order to do that, you've probably got to, once you start working on it, ADA and all the compliances, and how much is that going to cost? Is that going to, you know, do we put a lot of money into it, condominiumize it, you know, and have two separate condos? Do we just sell the building, which has been discussed, but it's like, you know, as a last resort? But because that Smith here,
sorry to interrupt.
That's okay.
Can you just talk for a second? What is, I understand, I've visited the building. It's a really very interesting building. And, and certainly the institution itself is, as far as I can tell, totally unique in terms of
how
institutions are structured.
Yeah.
I wonder if you could talk just for a few minutes about what connection the building itself has to your vision, though, at this point.
To our mission?
Sure. I mean, you said it wasn't original to the institution. It was
after Albert. Oh, no. The Smith Charities built that building.
Well, I understand, but it was built after the institution was founded.
No. Oliver died and set up the trust. And then the trustees built the building to house Smith Charities.
Right.
So Smith Charities has been in existence in that building for 170 years.
Right.
I was trying to think of another institution that was established and had been operating out of the same building for 170 years,
right,
which to me was unique in itself.
Right, so beyond that fact, though, I mean, just in a practical sense.
Could we do what we do someplace else?
Well, is there what is the case to be made to the public that the money is made to connect, make a connection between the building and the institution that the building
if the institution has to put money into the building preservation, then that money is money that we could be giving to the beneficiaries. So one of the things was what resources are going to be diminished, what resources are at risk?
Here's full disclosure, I'm an architect and I do studies like this, and I'm not going after this project or anything, but I...
But what's your name, not paternalist?
No, thanks. But I do worry that it can be very difficult, beyond just saying, oh, the brick is falling here, and purely physical report of what's failing in the building. In terms of feasibility, a big part of that has to come from the institution in terms of what the goals are.
Well, if we're
the goals
able,
for the building,
if we're able to rent the upstairs space,
mm-hmm.
then that's more money that we can put out to the community.
Mm-hmm.
So that
and is that written down? Like that's our goal for the, I guess I'm just.
Well, I think it said in the feasibility for the.
Are you curious as to whether or not they can do what they do elsewhere? I mean, are you trying to make a nexus between them and say there's more than just a space here? I'm just trying to further your question.
I guess I'm trying to understand. I mean, it's surely an admirable mission of the institution, but I think, you know, as we do with other institutions, I mean, there's the institution and there's the building.
Right.
And they're not the same thing.
Right.
No, because we could sell the building and build a small one next door.
And there's very good reasons why.
In the limited space that you have in downtown Northampton. we have a side yard. But, you know, I thought about checking open space, but I was like, But I mean, that's one thing that was brought up. It's like, okay, how do we survive? But it would be such a shame to break that tie, that uniqueness of having that entity in that same space. That's a historical significance in itself to me. I can't think of any place else that has that same history.
Well,
yes?
Chris Hellman, thanks Lydia for your time.
Let me
come at it from a slightly different way. One of the things that I perceive the function of this group is to fund projects that where we can demonstrate an enhancement of the public good.
Okay.
And while the organization's function may fulfill that. I'm not entirely sure I see the connection between this project and that. I also...
So if you were Smith Charities.
Yeah.
And you wanted to develop a long-range plan, because I don't know who the trustees are going to be in 6 years, 7 years, but if there's a map and groundwork set for the future of the building and Smith Charities, then they've got something to go by. If you've got another way to approach it, I'm all ears, because this is what, when I talk to the guys at the state, this is what they look favorably on, is something that has the professional groundwork and then other projects building on that. I'll come at it from sort of a combination of the two, I think. I mean, you're talking about preserving clearly an historic building here, and
right.
I think that falls within the CPC. You're
mm-hmm.
talking about doing a study, and at least speaking for myself, I absolutely agree that that's the place to start, and that's the way to ensure that the money is well spent. Where I'm having trouble is sort of on the scope of the study. Preserving the building, I think, is falls within the Community Preservation Act. Enhancing the redesigning the interior in a way that will increase perhaps your revenue stream,
correct?
Which then ultimately will help you advance your mission. That's where that connection breaks down, I think, with the Community Preservation Act. So funding the feasibility of doing interior renovations to alter to enhance the revenue, to alter the use, I think is outside our purview. I think looking at doing a feasibility study of what's necessary to preserve the structure itself from deterioration is something that we could look at. That ultimately, looking to, in my opinion, others may have a different opinion, but in my opinion, ultimately looking to community preservation funds to do, say, renovations to the second floor to make it into office space or residential space or whatever, I think that's off the table for our source of funding.
For your source of funding.
Some work on the envelope to preserve the structure so that people passing by can, you know, have a structural.
So when you're talking about historic preservation, it's really only tangible history, tangible preservation that you deal with?
Yeah.
Yes.
Not the fact that the whole...
Well, I mean, and that argument I think has been made before, and it's a slippery slope because it can cover almost everything.
Yeah.
I appreciate the quandary, and I think it's the problem is it puts this essence of it is what the money.
So
this
the study was just for the preservation of just for the outside of the building.
I think the issue is that those two purposes, renovation of the second floor, which I might think is a fantastic idea in terms of the long term and the longevity of
and
could be completely contradictory purposes to the historic preservation goals.
Okay.
In other words,
but isn't that
but
preserving?
If the second floor is damaged.
Yeah.
So
with no heat and deteriorating.
Not putting the heat in necessarily, because that's another story. But if the second floor is really damaged, then that would be. I mean, I'm asking. That would be
if there's no public.
Okay. All right.
Totally
that's what I'm asking. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I think I don't even know that we know the answers to these questions. I guess I came out of this with more questions than answers, obviously. I guess it's very easy for me to imagine a situation where the result of this report is to make it, to preserve this building, we're gonna do X, Y, Z. To make the second floor accessible, we're gonna really have to make some significant changes to the historic fabric on the exterior of the building and the interior, I mean, stairs and all those things, which are, in a sense, retroactively, the money for historic, they're supposed to be for historic preservation from the CDC is gonna end up going to something, David's not here to talk about that further, but could be counter to that. And I guess I'm just not.
What do you mean counter to that?
In other words, putting a big elevator stack and fire stair on the exterior of the building and totally redoing the.
Well, interior. I know the
I don't know that that's the answer, but I'm feeling it somehow.
I have three RFPs from the state that they've sent me, so that I could get an idea of, okay, what would this RFP look like? Mm-hmm. And I know the one that I'm kind of using as my guide is constantly with an eye toward historical preservation. So it's
for
like,
state grants, you mean?
Hmm?
For state grants.
For the state grant, right. Mm-hmm. But it's, the RFP is gonna be the same, it's the same money is being used for the same study. So they're not just gonna put some ugly thing on, it's all gotta be within the character of the building.
The committee had a really similar discussion regarding the study for the grandstand at the Three County Fairgrounds, and the result of that was partial funding for the parts of the study that were most related to historic preservation,
right,
and ensuring that a historic preservation.
Right, I'm asking for half of what the study's going to cost,
yeah.
And then if I get a little better reception than here, at the other communities, no, I'm just kidding.
You have sympathy.
then hopefully I can knock another 10,000 or 7,500 off of that, and yours would only be 10 instead of 17,500.
I hope these questions aren't, I don't want to come off as aggressive. I totally, taking away the conditions of CPC, I really think this is a great project and should move forward. But I think it's a much harder case to these other communities because they don't walk by this building every day.
No,
and the state certainly is going to have very rigorous requirements, and I think something like we're part, funding the parts that are historic preservation.
Right.
But I think when you go to those other places, I think your argument needs to be pointed, I think, and having a very clear goal, and maybe it's in there somewhere, and I think you did have a lot of information in here, so I think.
I import everything.
Yeah.
Into there.
And just to refresh our memory, Sarah, at least my memory, it is within the purview of communities outside of Northampton to fund projects like the Smith Charity Building, like the County Courthouse, even though they're outside of Northampton.
They're legally able to do it. Most of them aren't especially keen to do that. So like what the Council of Governments had, was it the town of Goshen that funded a little bit? But they certainly are able to.
They're able to do it, but it is
it's a
difficult sell.
It's an uphill battle. I think one of the biggest things I probably have going, other than maybe tweaking my argument, thank you very much, is the fact that I can show how much money's gone back to these communities. It's like we've never come and asked for any money. We've always been able to take care of the building. We're just in an economical situation that.
Mm-hmm. But that's exactly why you need to make that very clear case of why the building has anything to do with your mission. Because if you live in East Hampton, they don't care where the envelope comes from.
Mm.
It could be coming from a P.O. box somewhere, anywhere. The check clears, right? I mean, but I'm not saying that doesn't exist. I'm saying that's the case to be made.
Is what the building has.
The building
to do
and the mission have anything to do with each other. And I don't have that answer for you, but I think that is exactly the case, especially if you're going to go to people outside of Northampton to say anything like that. I think it's such an interesting building. And I thought the same. When I walked it out a couple years ago, I thought, there's so much potential here. So.
Well, you should come and see that woodwork down cellar.
Are we able to just drop in,
sure,
view it, or do we need to call ahead?
No, just drop in. The treasurer is there, and another woman, and they'll, you know, Jane Lebecki's the treasurer, Carla Cohn is his assistant, and they'd be happy to take it. We get people a lot of times coming in, and we had a guy from Northampton, Ohio. It was Ohio.
Excellent.
It was where Oliver had invested and made a lot of his money in real estate. And he was from the Historic Commission and came by and toured the whole building, and you know, they were happy to show him. They, especially Jane, Carla too, but Jane is Smith Cherry. She pours her heart and soul into that place. So she'll show it off like a proud mother.
What's the scale of the mortgage lending business that you did?
We've got about $4 million that they loan out. And so it's small enough that a lot of times we're loaned out, so we don't have any money to lend. We kind of have to call ahead to see, you know, if there's money, or Jane will be able to tell you, oh, well, we don't have any right now, but we're, you know, these are being paid off, and in another 6 months I'll have X, and then put you on a list, and they'll be like a waiting list. They're very conservative. I think it's like a 40 to 60% ratio. Your credit score has got to be immaculate, because they're risking the beneficiaries' funds, so they're very, very conservative. But we seem to be able to keep ourselves loaned out, which is really all we can do right now, is just keep that money working.
Lydia, you mentioned the open space on the side of the building, and that's sort of related to accessibility, and even though the building is open 9 to 3, it's not a place that people generally go, but the open space is currently closed off.
Correct. It's fenced because they want to protect it from...
Has there ever been any thought of making that, or at least a portion of it, available to the public?
A portion of the open space to the side?
Yeah.
I don't think so, because... we haven't been dealing with the people sleeping on the steps and different people. So it's kind of a two-edged sword. You want to open it up, but then you also open it up to, you know, some bad things happening. So we're just trying to protect the building.
Has there ever been any exploration of partnering with another institution, a nonprofit, something, I don't know what kind, but...
Well, I think
big building.
It is, but I think it's the accessibility. There's only one door, and that's the front door. So anybody that we would partner up with, or you know, have them upstairs or whatever, mm-hmm. would have to go through Smith Charities to access upstairs. Mm-hmm. So part of the study, and that, you know, that could be, the study may not be this whole elevator and everything like that. It could be maybe a smaller scale plan to be able to get another nonprofit in there, or somebody else on a smaller scale. Because isn't there a threshold for ADA? It's like if you're spending.
Yeah, if you spend over a. 30, there's different threshold, 30% of the value of the building.
Right.
But also, if you have a change of occupancy, there's other things that can trigger. Yeah. Well, sprinkling. You know,
right.
So
I don't know any of this, so hence the study.
Right. Sure.
You know, is it going to be a full-blown elevator and all that for upstairs? Maybe not. Maybe the feasibility of the use of that upstairs is something else.
Have you spoken to consultants about the number for, I think, 35,000, where does that number come from?
A best guesstimate based on the 3 RFPs that I have.
You got 3 proposals.
Mm-hmm.
Are those included? Is those the ones that are included here?
No, they're not in there.
Not for her work.
They're not for my work.
No,
oh,
no,
I
no,
see
no. No. I got samples.
I see. Okay.
And...
We have a historic building.
Sure.
Right.
Yeah.
So I read all 3 of them bumped it up a little bit because they were, you know, 6 or 7 years old and figured things were going to be more expensive. Ran it by an architect guy, friend of mine.
Lydia, my assumption would be if the study was completed, they would recommend renovations that would be in the at least the hundreds of thousands of dollars. Do you have any idea where that money would come from? What is difficult for us is to fund a study without knowing that follow-up work could be done to initiate ways to fund that.
Right, and I think I when I answered one of the questions, I think that was one of the questions that Sarah had sent to me, and part of the study was a kind of a timeline of what should be done now, what can be done in the future, you know, a year down the road, 5 years, 10 years down the road, and hoping that those interest rates go up. If, you know, in 5 years we have more money, or 10 years we would have more money to be able to put into a project. If they're saying that the south side of the building is falling down and you guys better do something right away, then boom, I'm back to the CPC and the state and for a specific project.
Thank you. Any other questions? And once again, Lydia, 2 weeks from tonight, we have open for public commenting on proposals. So if there are folks you would like to bring, please do so.
Okay.
At that time. Thank you very much.
You're
welcome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, and last but not least, the Hampshire County Courthouse.
Mr. Chairman. Good evening, everyone. Just made it. Thank you very much. My name is Todd Ford. I am the Executive Director of the Hampshire Council of Governments. I live in Florence. Before I start, who was here a couple years ago when we came for our first request that went towards preservation of Sears? It's the chairman. All right, great. Well,
Dave was.
We'll go through this a little slower than I anticipated. although I am the Executive Director of the Hampshire Council of Governments, I just want to start by stating that I'm not here necessarily on behalf of the Hampshire Council. I am here on behalf of the owners of the old courthouse, which are all the inhabitants of Hampshire County, as it states on the deed. So the Hampshire Council of Governments, for lack of any other caretaker, has been trying to take care of the building to the best of its ability since the Hampshire Council was formed in 1999. Before that, obviously, it was the county, had a much more stable revenue stream. It was part of the court, a little bit more officially part of the court system. But since 99, the HCOG has been doing its best to take care of the building, take care of relatively routine maintenance. We do have a maintenance person on staff that takes care of the grounds as well as the building. If you're not familiar with the building, I at this time certainly ask that you come and get a tour with me, and I'll be glad to show you around. It is perhaps one of the most historic structures in the city, and certainly one of the most prominent public structures in the city and perhaps in the county. It was built in 1886 on very historic ground. It's where Shays' Rebellion started. It was the site of the first public building in the city of Northampton. It was the site of two courthouses. The courthouse before this one actually was the very courthouse in which Smith Charities was founded in the legal battle that Daniel Webster came up and participated in. And that was so popular that people were hanging off the rafters and on ladders viewing that trial. The site obviously was home of many trials. It was the county seat since the county's inception in the 1600s. And it's been the site of many trials and remains a prominently important building with the legal community. The third floor is the historic courtroom. It is leased by the state court system. That's where the jury selection for the recent murder trial took place. It's where Amy Carter was tried for sitting in UMass Amherst. So it was the site of important trials. It remains the site of important trials and work with the legal community. As you are probably aware, the grounds of the courthouse are always open to the public, and we try to program that space as much as we can. It is the site of the annual 4th of July new citizen swearing-in ceremony. Downstairs in the courthouse is the Hampshire County Law Library, used by city councilors and lawyers and other people involved in legal battles. It is also host to the nonprofit meetings, other type of meetings that take place in the master meeting room on the second floor. Wired West is meeting there right now. The second floor is also home to an arts night out space, an art gallery. Greg Stone had his last exhibit there before he passed a couple weeks ago. We also have the annual summer concert series. We have the Cancer Connection Camp Out with Monty Belmonte. Again, we just try to program that space as often as we can and make sure it's continuing to be a vital part of not only Northampton, but the entire county and community. So the history of this project dates back maybe 4 years now when we had an architectural assessment done. That was funded by a donation from the Grosbeck Foundation. Mr. Grosbeck was a lawyer and a judge who practiced in the building. There's a plaque in his honor on the second floor. His family now happens to also own the Celtics, so we keep asking the Grosbeck Foundation for more. But that assessment was paid for out of the Grosbeck Foundation and also with assistance from the state with a historic grant. And that showed us that the building was in dire need of restoration. And there were some priorities that were set forth, which I'll get into later, but we knew we had our work cut out for us to preserve the building before it crumbled before. So we started raising money. We have raised $33,000 from local banks. The committee, your predecessors, were generous enough to award us $100,000 in our first application for the CPA. And as was mentioned earlier, we made applications to all the Community Preservation Acts throughout Hampshire County at that time. And the small little town of Goshen saw value in the project, and their CPA gave the full ask that we asked of them, which was $8,000, which was their share based on the percent of their population in overall Hampshire County out of the $1.1 or $1.3 million that we allocated towards all of the communities in Hampshire County. So they really set the bar and the standard for other communities jumping in and helping to preserve the building, which I'll get into later. We've also been working with the legal community. We will be announcing very shortly a legal foundation, which will be to honor an attorney who recently passed. And in working with them, we're going to have a memorial plaque for that attorney. And people may make donations to have a place on that plaque as judged by a panel that will be looking for people that have kind of equal contributions to the community, to helping people who can't help themselves, et cetera. And we hope that that will raise money both for their foundation as well as for the preservation of the structure. And we also launched our Buy a Brick campaign, Brick Fest, which has raised thousands of dollars from private donations, private citizens and businesses who see the value in the structure. We've also had a petition drive, which had about 6,000 signatures on the petition to asking for the preservation of the structure, and that went to the governor. So all the money that we fundraised in the first round, we were able to use to leverage the state to release the first $500,000 from a total of $4 million bond authorization that our local legislative delegation was good enough to put into a bond bill. So that means that the state has allocated the money, a total of $4 million, but every time we want some of that money, we have to go through a process, and each governor has a different process, and ask for the release of the money. So that was some of the questions that you had, which we can get into later. So we know that the state likes to see local support and that it's very helpful in getting them to release the money upon which the entire project is dependent. So let's not mince any words. Without the state's $4 million, that building does not get preserved, at least in my lifetime. I don't know how else to preserve the structure. We've looked at every possible way, including tax credits, et cetera. But as a governmental body and as a governmental building, more importantly, that's deeded to the public good, a lot of the avenues that are open even to nonprofits are not open to that particular building. The building need for the preservation is acute. So the stairs, which you helped fund their restoration, they were sinking into the ground. There was no foundation on those stairs. The treads were pulling away. It was becoming very dangerous and hazardous. And so we spent about $600,000 to restore the front stairs, the front roof, which was leaking, as well as the side stairs on Gothic Street. All the original materials were used, and we're currently going through the process of certifying that work so we can get actually the $100,000 that your predecessors awarded us. The next priority that the architect saw was the tower, and that's what we're here this evening to talk about. The tower is literally falling apart. There are pieces of flashing that are falling onto the ground. There are bits of tile from the roof, the clay tiles from the roof are falling off. And I have all these in my office if you want to come see them. They ran on the ground and I picked them up. The N, which is part of the weather vane on the top, which is that's almost 100 feet high, that fell off. It's made of cast iron, pretty heavy. I'm glad no one was hurt. So the building is it's literally falling apart. And I'll get into the reasons why in a minute. But if you do come for the tour, I'll show you the interior of the tower. It's a completely porous environment at this point. All the windows are leaking. The mortar is falling apart. The area between the wood joists and the mortar and the bricks is leaking. So water is really penetrating the tower quite badly. That seeps all the way through the tower into the interior of the building and is really creating an unstable area. So that is the second priority that we hope to tackle with the 1.3 that we asked from the state, adding to that the monies that we get from private donations as well as the CPA committees. There's an architect statement next in the slide, but what I want to do is actually I just received this tonight, so if you'll beg my pardon. This is a letter from our architect who performed the assessment, and he also was our architect for the work on the front and side stairs. And he writes to Commissioner Gladstone, who, as you know, did not decide to prioritize this project for preservation. He writes, "As the architect that performed the assessment of the historic Hampshire County Courthouse, I was distressed by your decision not to release capital bond funds to assist with the restoration and preservation of the historic building. In addition to completing the building study, I have overseen restoration work done to date and have witnessed the continued deterioration and decline of the building. The tower is slowly collapsing from water penetration, holes in the roof, sill rot, and faulty mortar. Within the last few months, metal flashing from one of the windows has fallen, and the original terracotta tiles are beginning to fall around the building, endangering pedestrians and court staff. Masonry has become compromised, water is penetrating the walls, and plants are growing between the mortar. Stress cracks can be seen in several areas of the interior of the building, and every window of the lower and the tower has sill rot. Water penetrating the building from the tower enters the walls, affecting the interior of the building, compromising its structural integrity. Most disconcerting is the public hazard that these incidents create. Luckily, no one has been hurt. This is a serious situation caused by decades of deferred maintenance. I strongly urge DECAN to release the capital bond funding approved by the legislature without further delay. The current situation is unsafe, and further delay places the public and the history of Hampshire County in peril." Couldn't agree with it more. So where are we now? So along with this request and for the Northampton CPC, we are also making requests to all the other communities in Hampshire County once again, except for Goshen, because they paid their fair share. So that includes East Hampton, Hatfield, Hadley, et cetera. The towns that do have CPAs or CPCs in place, we will go through that process. Towns that do not have CPCs, we're asking for an outright donation from the community. I understand that that is an uphill battle, even beyond a community with a CPC, but I think that, you know, the Northampton application is key. I was in East Hampton several weeks ago with our application in front of them, and they said, "Well, come back to us when you have your answer from Northampton." So I think that just speaks to, obviously, the rest of the county communities wanting to see Northampton fulfill their fair share of the obligation. And by the way, the $140,000 is the full share, that's the remaining of the share that we went through the calculation with. So that would be the last request from the Hampshire Foundation for the preservation of the courthouse, again, at least in my lifetime. So we won't be back if this request is granted. We will continue to fundraise from local banks and institutions. We have several applications pending with them. We'll continue Brickfest to raise money from the private citizens and businesses of Northampton and Hampshire County. And I am glad to answer any of your questions.
Thank you, Todd. Questions?
So the first time around, only Goshen was willing to contribute funds in addition to the city of Northampton?
Correct.
And all the other communities were asked?
Correct. And that was a town, so I just got to go to town meeting.
So that's not that fun. So explain to me the, there's something off in this situation, and it may be that that's just the way it is, but I want to understand better. Because $4 million was allocated. I understand you have to go through the process of actually appropriating it, and that there's a priority list, and you have to get in line for that. But that, am I correct that that should just about fully fund the renovations that are necessary?
That would fully fund the prioritized recommendations when the assessment was originally done. I can almost guarantee you that it's going to be much more than that when all is said and done. The original price request for the front steps and the side steps were about $400,000. It ended up being $200,000 more than that. So the amount of work and the complication of the work, I think, is really going to push that budget up. Now, further, the assessment really didn't get into the landscape at all, nor did it get into the fence. So that very rare cast iron fence that surrounds that property that survived both world wars, which is a miracle, needs about $1.3 million in restoration. So I think, you know, that building could absorb quite a bit to make it what it really should be. That's not what we're really talking about tonight. What we're talking about tonight is restoring it to the point where it doesn't fall down, and I think perhaps my predecessor can take up the landscape improvements and preserve that fence.
So what do you assuming Northampton were able to contribute this, and assuming that the other communities did not follow suit, what happens the next phase when there's no match? How do you get these bond funds released?
Well, that's a good question. So I think that it's always political on some level. And I think, you know, even if one town can step in, like per round where we go and ask for the release, I think that would be very valuable. I think DCAM is going to see the error of their ways. We have a tour scheduled with members of the delegation and all media from Hampshire County and beyond invited this Friday. We have a short documentary that we're filming with Northampton TV that'll be about 25 minutes long. Talking about the importance of the structure, and we'll be sending that to the governor and his representatives as well. So we are pulling out all the stops to get the money that the legislature worked so hard to get allocated for this building to the city of Northampton and to the building in a timely manner.
Todd, I still don't get it. So DCAM was essentially got $4 million, which they are now not releasing.
No. So the money is allocated, but it's not budgeted, or it's part of a bond bill. So what that does, the legislature can put in these bond bills really almost anything they want, and then in order to get the money bonded and then receive the money, it has to go through a more of a bureaucratic process with the governor's secretary.
There's no money set aside, is what you're saying.
There's no money. Right. They haven't issued the bond of the 1.3 that we've requested to receive the actual cash.
And I'm still confused how our $130,000 would expedite that.
As I said, it seems to be politics. So our understanding through conversations with Senator Rosenberg's office and others is that local participation and match and contribution can add to the political pressure that the delegation can then apply to DCAM through the governor, et cetera.
So I understand that DCAM and UMBA, when they told these ones, they wrapped a bunch of projects together, so they bond them together to that group.
If we allocate $130,000 and DCAM, the bond did not come through, what would you do with that $130,000? No one else.
Probably nothing. I'd probably keep it earmarked for the full term that we would able to keep it earmarked and continue to push for DCAM. I mean, the building needs, you know, $4 plus million restoration. $130 is not going to do do anything concrete enough to save the building. It would be disrespectful to you and the citizens of Northampton.
But this phase two is 1.3 million?
Yes.
And how much was the first phase?
Well, it went from $400,000 to over $600,000 for the stairs.
And have you gotten the money for that? Was it retroactive? You get the money after the work's done?
Yep. So we're still working with the city. There was an issue of the conservation restriction. We had to get it surveyed, et cetera, but we should be all set to get the $100,000 reimbursement from Northampton. We received the $8,000 from the city of the town of Goshen, and we've obviously received the $500,000 from the state.
Okay, so.
The fencing that you mentioned is not in the form later?
No.
So what's just out of interest, what's the next phase, assuming you get through phase two here?
Yeah, so the next phase is really the mortar and the foundation and the main slate roof. So the tower is the area with the majority of the water penetration and the majority of the damage, but that slate roof, if you look at it carefully, it is sagging. It's the original slate from 1886, so that needs some restoration as well. But perhaps most importantly, that building is in essence made of rubble. So if you peel back that granite that makes it look so sturdy, beyond that is just dust and debris. And at the base of it, it's about 5 feet thick, and then it gets gradually more narrow as it goes up to the top. But the mortar that was originally used in 1886 is completely disintegrated, so it's a dusty type of mortar. So the next phase would be to remove all the granite from the base of the building all the way up to the top, to the first row of brownstone, and reinforce it with poured concrete.
It's very hard to estimate the cost of those before you
open.
Yeah, part of the assessment was to open the building up in several locations, and that, you know, that's how the stairs were identified as, you know, the most egregious need.
And since there are windows in that space?
Yeah, so those windows that you see, those nasty plexiglass things, were added in the early 70s. They are not the original intent of the architect, so the windows need to be replaced in their original historic form. Yeah, so the whole building's part of the historic district, so everything that we do to the building needs to be adhered to the historic guidelines.
And is that it, or is there a further phase beyond that? I understand there's much more you could do, but that you was identified.
Yeah, beyond that is more some detail work, putting the flagpole back up on the top. That weather vane is not historic. The historic use of the very top of the tower is a flagpole. So dealing with any kind of, you know, kind of finishing touches to make that building shine as it should.
If we were to allocate the $140,000, but one of the conditions would be we would release the money only if the bond went through, would that be acceptable?
Yes. In fact, that would put even more pressure on.
Todd, Chris Hellman, thanks for coming in. You mentioned that there's a tour on Friday.
Yep.
Would it be okay if I tagged along?
Sure.
And if so, what time?
Good question.
I'll follow up with you. It's fine. It's...
No, I'd like to know. Yeah.
Well, that raises the question. If three of us are there, do we have any problems with the open meeting law? If it's a public,
you can walk around and look at everything
and not talk
and
to
nod
each other.
Yeah, you know, right.
It's 2:00.
Okay, great.
2:00.
So it will be hopefully a bit of a circus. The mayor will be there. Senator Rosenberg will be there. Other senators and representatives, and hopefully as much media as possible.
And where in the courthouse is it?
If you just come up the front steps, and we'll be letting people.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Other questions for Todd? So once again, in 2 weeks, we'll be having the public comments. If you would like other folks to speak on the courthouse behalf, please encourage them to come. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you.
Good
all.
Luck.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank
you. Okay, we will be out of here in plenty of time for those of us that are masochists and want to subject ourselves to yet another round of stuff.
Pitchers playing again? All right, so we
talking about the Cubs game?
The Cubs are playing right
the
now.
The Cubs game.
Oh, yeah. So we have two quick memorandums of understanding to look at.
They are identical except for the names and the applicable.
And again, what we really have control over, if you have it in front of you, is the, really the last sentence, which is the conditions that we put forth. And in this case, for both of these projects, we're setting forth conditions that simply have to do with signing or acknowledgement that the shelving is partially funded through through CPC, and that that be in sort of permanent, permanent record. So is there a motion? I think we can do this as a package deal, perhaps? Or do we do one at a time?
You can do both.
Is there a motion to approve these memorandums of agreement?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion or additional on additional conditions? For those new folks who haven't seen this, this is pretty much standard language that we get from
and
the city.
For anyone who's new, we generally do a contract, but this is well below the city's contract threshold, which is faster for the applicant, for the small grants as well.
Which is the purpose of the, one of the purposes of the small grant. Any discussion on these? Okay, all those in favor of approval? Opposed? Good to go. Other business not foreseen when agenda was published?
The only thing I have is site visits. This past Saturday turned out not really to work so well for people. So do we want to try again, or is just a self-guided tour map enough for everybody?
So we have the Friday option for the courthouse, correct, at 2 o'clock. And then anytime we want, it seems, for Smith Charity.
Yeah, and a lot of people went to the Greenway this past Friday.
Do folks want Sarah to set up stuff for, would be this Saturday, is that right?
It doesn't have to be.
The bond turtle thing was something that would be tricky to look at self-guided.
It's tough anyway.
Yeah.
You drive to the end of Ellington Road and kind of do this. Yeah. There's a little walkway out of the park. If anybody wants to do that, I could give a little tour of that one.
I'm set. I'm really not interested in the open spaces. I think you can look at a field that it's a field. So, but I'm glad we're going to be able to do one on Friday.
You need to rephrase that.
I'm glad Mark
said you're very interested.
Not hear you say that.
You're very interested. You're simply not just going to site visits. Is that
no, I'm very interested in the work, but I mean, one field, you could drop me in the middle of each of them and I wouldn't know one from the other, is what I'm saying. So, but I am interested in seeing the City Hall thing. The fact that they've got Friday, that'll be fine.
So if anybody wants to go to the open space ones, just shoot me an email and tell me when you're available and I will be take you to those.
So once again, if we know of folks who are interested in commenting on any of these 8 proposals, is that correct, that we have? We'll be meeting again on the, what's the date?
November 2nd.
Will be our meeting to listen to public comments on these.
And then I did have one other matter. Sarah, if you can help me with this.
Sure.
This is back to the affordable housing proposals. There was some discussion about if the 80% didn't work, going to 120%. And I should have raised this last time, but in my mind, 100% is the moderate income cut off. And so maybe I'm forgetting or missing something, but I would.
Yeah, Wayne, I misspoke, but what he's proposing seems to make sense.
Well, his proposal is if the 80% doesn't work, he's going to make it up to 120%.
Which is too high. Unless it's
too high.
For seniors.
And I think,
okay.
I think he checked in and said is 120% right. And
yeah, I was thinking.
He got a yes, but
see,
I don't
see
think
for
that
senior
is.
Housing, it would be 120%.
But this is not.
No, it's not.
Yeah.
So
he may want to modify his proposal to make sure that it's. eligible as community housing.
And that is within our ability to set as a condition.
We could do it that
as
way
well,
as
which
well,
we have done.
But we would need to make sure that we thought it was
right.
feasible.
Because we have done that in the past,
yeah.
is look at what those income eligibility
right.
and set ours as a condition. So thank you for bringing that. Any other business?
I just wanted to say that I don't know this for a fact in dealing with the state, but in the federal level, my experience has been that when grant money like that is being held up, it really, I mean, yes, having the $140,000 that we have, that we might allocate in their pocket is persuasive, but they're talking about things that are not necessarily driven by the project themselves, and he alluded to the politics of it, but they could approve every one of these but one kind of thing. And so this I was really intrigued by the fact that he actually sort of left on the idea of conditioning the money on the grant being released, because I think that's the way to go. There's no way that he can with a straight face guarantee that money's going to be made available. It's just it might be something we want to have a conversation with our state reps about what they think the likelihood are, you know, which way the wind's blowing on something like that. And I don't know how closely they've been paying attention to it, but.
The city's had cases
in
the past where money has been allocated in the same way by our local legislators, and it never
yeah.
materialized for various reasons.
Yeah, see, that's my only concern, because I've chased money like that at the federal level, and it can take years if it happens at all. So
I missed. What is the 2 o'clock tour? I mean, what is the point of that tour?
Oh, it's a media event. We're trying to get publicity
for this $4 million
mm-hmm.
month. So that is
and important. To show people why it's important.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, but I think local support has to come first.
Yeah, absolutely. That's one of the reasons why, you know, I'm definitely going to go. You know,
that would be helpful that at least some of us go.
Yeah.
And hear what goes on there. Let's see. Where are we in the process, Anne, of having you be approved?
That was my question. I've gone to some committee, as it were.
Yeah, it got her appointment. All appointment gets referred out to. I think it's the City Council Committee on City Services,
okay.
And I don't know if they've met yet.
Okay. Is that something you're able to ask on
yes.
our behalf?
Yes.
Otherwise, it'd be nice to have you voting.
Yes.
For or against
yes.
proposals as it comes up. Your official membership. Anything else? Other business? Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
A second. All right. Thank you very much. See you too.